Okay, good evening, everybody. We're gonna go ahead and get started tonight. I'm gonna try to put on a happy face. Are you all, everybody happy? You know, Christians are supposed to always be happy. You're never to have any burdens or cares or concerns. You go through life without any trouble. That's all just being facetious. So anyway, let's just ask the Lord to bless tonight the word that we're going to go through. And I had said we were going to talk about the ministering spirits, which I'm just going to kind of mention, but we're going to just go through a little bit of the letter of Jude and some of the things you'll remember we talked about not too long ago, but I want to just sort of do some of it in a different light. But it does refer to Michael the Archangel and some of those areas, so I'll mention that. But then Sunday morning we'll pick all that up and we'll talk a little bit about those ministering spirits, as the Bible says, because we've been talking about transference of spirits. And you know, they say that your Facebook and your phone and so on is not all hooked together and they're not really listening to you, but somehow it keeps happening. I mentioned transfer of spirits in a conversation I was having, and all of a sudden a YouTube video pops up with transference of spirits. I don't know who the group is, but anyway, but I'm sure it's just a coincidence. As well as how many times you've mentioned somebody or talked to somebody about somebody and all of a sudden they pop up on your Facebook or something, you should friend them. But I'm sure that's a coincidence too. Just like when you look for a car and then all of a sudden all those car ads pop up, it's just a coincidence. Don't let it bother you. Amen? Well, Father, we come to you tonight in Jesus' name. And Lord, we thank you in all of this for your mercy and grace. And thank you for the blood of Jesus that was shed on that cross for all of our souls. And for so many more that don't even know you as yet, he died for them also. And so, Father, tonight as we pray, and Lord, you said that we should pray for laborers in the harvest, because the harvest is so vast, so many areas, so many fields, so many places where there are those that are hungering for the truth of the gospel. And some of them don't even understand it's what they're looking for, but when they hear it, they'll know it. And so, Father, we pray for those things tonight in Jesus' name. And we continue to pray, as we talked about Sunday morning, to bring forth fruit. And Lord God, you said you are glorified in that we bear much fruit. We want our lives to be fruitful. We want the investment that Jesus made on the cross in every one of us to bring forth fruit worthy of who he is and what he's done. And so, Lord, we commit all this to you tonight. We ask you to bless this word and just direct and guide us as we go through these things. And Father, thank you that it's going to minister to us, maybe in areas we don't even have need just yet, but down the road you'll bring them to remembrance. And so we thank you for that right now, Lord, that we're not just bringing and speaking forth words. Father, this is the word of God. This is the power of God and the salvation to all who believe it. So we thank you for that. Pray your protection on the rest of our brethren that may not be able to be here with us tonight. Father, and some who are watching from home online, we pray you bless them and all of our guests. We pray this word reach and stir in every one of us. And we thank you for it all. In Jesus' name, we ask. Amen. 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 Well, go ahead and say hi to everybody again tonight. And I know we say this all the time, and some of you get here early enough to say hello, and some just get here in time, so I don't want you to miss out on the fellowship of the saints and the brethren. So, I said we'll go to the book of Jude tonight, so if you will, open up to chapter 1 of the book of Jude, which I'm sure you all remember there is only one chapter. And we're going to look at this a little bit different. And what I want you to see here, is the terminology beloved, how he refers to the saints as the beloved. And I'll just show you a little bit here as we get down there a little ways, but it begins by saying, Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father. Anybody here sanctified by God? Amen. Yep, every one of us should be. Everyone who names the name of Jesus, professes to be a believer in Jesus, and says they're walking with the Lord, they should be sanctified by God and preserved in Jesus Christ and called. Now, Sunday we talked about being kept by the power of God. What do you do when you preserve things? When you take strawberries and you preserve them, when you do canning, you're preserving things so that they can be kept. So the Lord Jesus is preserving us. He's keeping us. We're kept by the power of God. And again, as we talked about just a few weeks back, you see your brethren, or your calling brethren, and here he says, and called. So we are sanctified by God the Father. We're preserved in Jesus Christ. Now, how many of you remember what we read in John 15 Sunday morning? Abide in me and let my words abide in you. Abide in me. We are kept in him. Our life is hid in Christ, according to what the Bible tells us. So when we're wondering what value do we have, listen, if we can't see anything, go to the Word of God and remember you are in Christ Jesus. You are preserved in him. And he has a way that he's made for every one of us. And he called us. Again, we're the called of the Lord. Not one of us came to the Lord because we said one day, I'm going to go serve God. Everything that brought us to that place was the orchestration of the Lord and the Holy Spirit moving in our lives and God sending witnesses, laborers in the harvest, right to our door, right to our person, right to where we were, whether it came over a radio program, person to person, one-on-one relationship, the Lord brought that to us. So he says we are sanctified, preserved in Jesus, and called. And he says, mercy unto you, and peace and love be multiplied. Now, if anybody's having a shortfall of mercy, peace, and love, say, hey, Lord, Jude said, be multiplied. I need that multiplied in my life. And there are days when we need to do that. Like I said today, I'm going to try to put on my happy face. And I'm not really going through anything. Although, how many of you know, you're always mindful of what's going on out here right now. This thing is like an oppression in the air with this pandemic. So you and I have to all be cautious in Christ that we're not subdued by that. When they were in the captivities as the people of God, they could have just fallen apart in that, or they could keep crying out and trusting in the Lord. And that's where we're to be. But he says, mercy unto you, because you know we all need mercy, right? That's why we're saved. It's the mercy of God. That's why we get up and go on, because the mercy of God is working in our lives. When we fall down, when we do some horrendous thing, it's his mercy that restores us. He doesn't crush us. He doesn't destroy us. He keeps us upright. And peace in the midst of a storm. Would you say today we're living in a storm? Would you say it's a trying time? It's a time where you say what it talks about in the scripture again, as though some strange thing has come upon you, the trial of your faith, and now we need patience because we're going to see another day. We're going to see a side of things that the Lord will bring to pass in all of our lives. And love. just knowing somebody loves us. And if people don't love us, the Lord loves us. Wow, is that a great thing? And sometimes we can be pretty unlovable as people, be misunderstood, but the Lord doesn't misunderstand us. We may be unlovable, but he loves us. And so we see in the blessing of, this is just a salutation, an opening to a letter. But in that, when the man of God, when you and I as men or women of God are speaking something to somebody, remember our words have power. And so when we're doing it in the Lord and doing it to affect somebody with some life, there's power in that. And so it says, "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints." Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you. Jude is saying here that it was highly important and a labor for me to write to you like this, but I felt that it was needed to be done. He says, "I gave all diligence to write unto you." In other words, he was putting forth everything he could to get this letter out to the beloved. But he said, "to write unto you of the common salvation." Now, how many of you remember or know what really does he mean, the common salvation? I brought a quote with me I'm going to read to you. Because, and lots of us have said this at various times. Well, let me read the quote first, and then I'll talk about that. And then I'll tell you who the quote is by. It says about the common salvation. "The necessity in the present case was that he should write about the common salvation. The question is, if it was common, commonly understood, and commonly received, why should he need to write about it?" Think about that. If we say this is the common salvation, everybody understood what common salvation was and had received the common salvation, he says, why then should we have need to write of it? Surely a common subject has enough written about it already. And it affords no room for freshness and novelty. In other words, we don't have to dress it up, which are so much desired by readers. And you may say, well, like, let's just say I've heard the story of the coming of the Lord and the virgin birth, and so now, you know, I've heard that a few times or every year at a certain time, and so can we dress it up some? Can we make it a little more? And that's what he's saying. It's one of those things. He says, "yet experience and observation prove that it is more necessary to preach the common doctrines of the gospel than any other truths." So he's saying we have to keep preaching and teaching, what is it in Hebrews 6, those foundation stones. Keep preaching and teaching the common salvation, which is remember how you and I came to the Lord. Remember what the Lord did for us. Remember that it is his mercy, it is his grace that we've come. So experience and observation prove that it is more necessary to preach the common doctrines of the gospel than any other truths, and that just those things which appear to be the most elementary or basic and the most generally received are those upon which it is most important to lay stress again and again. In other words, they need repeating, and you and I need constant reminder of what they are and how they should work in us. How many of you have ever said to somebody, well, listen, you very well know if you don't forgive, that will consume you. You really know that if you speak evil of somebody, and all of that could be looked at as a part of the common salvation, things that we realized even as babes in the Lord, or that we should not lie. A lot of things that are a part of that common salvation. So he says those are the most important to lay stress again and again. If there are certain high doctrines, speculative theories and dogmas, which are rather outgrowths of the gospel, in other words, well, we can take it to this place and that place, he says if it's those type of things, outgrowths of the gospel rather than the gospel itself, let them be preached in due proportion, but always bring in the main doctrine, the salvation, the common salvation. Always have these things because they are the basics that need to be reminded over and over. Let them be preached in due proportion. But if they are not preached, the risk and danger will not be extreme. I don't have to talk to people about going to heaven in a vision when they're not rooted and grounded in the faith. And if you never go to heaven in a vision, yet you're grounded in the faith, you're going to see heaven in reality in the end. Isn't that right? So he's saying, don't bother and worry about those things over and over again. Keep reminding of the basics and the common salvation. As for the rudimentary facts, the fundamental doctrines, the primary truths of Scripture, we must from day to day insist upon them. We must never say of them, everyone knows them. For alas, everyone forgets them. We must not cease from proclaiming them from fear of being charged with uttering mere platitudes. In other words, seek first the kingdom and all these things will be added to you. Oh, you just say that when you can't think of anything else to say. Ask, seek, knock. Well, that's a nice phraseology. You just say that. Mere platitudes. Okay? What is revealed by the Holy Spirit must not be spoken of so reproachfully. In other words, we should never touch Scripture with that kind of a heart or attitude. Let men call the doctrines of the gospel platitudes if they wish. We will only answer that our salvation rests upon such platitudes. After all, on certain grand, wide, well-known truths of universal acceptance, the Church of God is built. Charles Spurgeon, 1881. So he is saying the common salvation, and he says, don't assume that anybody remembers the very basics and doesn't need to be reminded of them, because he says, when you say everyone knows them, remember everyone forgets them. Remember what we talked about last week, the simplicity of the gospel, what the scripture said of that you would err from the very simplicity of the gospel. If I just do what the Lord says, if I just walk in obedience, as Waverly shared in the beginning, and I think he even mentioned that we had just talked about that a couple weeks back, if we'll humble ourselves, what the Lord will do for us. If we don't live lusting after all the things of the world. Again, we talked about love not the world, neither the things that are in it, right? Because those things are not of God. And so I don't know how many things I saw in the last 2 days, that very same scripture, I heard a preacher preaching on it. It's like I say this over and over again, of everything that's in the scripture, it's like these things keep coming up. So that was Charles Spurgeon talking about the common salvation. So it says, "Beloved, I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation. It was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith of the men of old, of the faith which was once delivered unto the saints." So when we look at that, the reason he's saying what he said is the message of faith was already under attack. And with us, the message of faith is under attack all the time, to believe on the Lord. We've got more and more atheists rising up and witches rising up and people, just humanitarian humanism rising up and saying, we don't need God. We've got a world system forming out here that says, we don't need God. We can do this. We've got it. You need to be a part of our system. So he says that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered. And I want to remind you that word contend means to wrestle and fight for. And all the time it's a fight in our lives. But here's the blessing is, all we have to do is remember we're kept by the power of God. Right? And what it said here today, that we're preserved in Jesus Christ. If we just stay in him, all these things he'll bring to pass in our lives, so that we can earnestly contend for that faith. And I know I say all the time, read Hebrews 11, where it talks about what mighty men those men of faith were and some of the acts that they did. And ask yourself, you may say, well, I'm not worthy of any of those things or to do any of those. I don't know how to go about those things. Well, listen, do you really think they knew exactly what to do when they entered into those places where God would now demonstrate and show to us, look at the acts of faith that these men did? When Joshua and Caleb went into the land, when they took Jericho, when various things happened, when Moses got to the sea and believed that God was going to get them somehow through what was in front of them? Do you think they knew that here's what's going to happen and here's how it's going to go? And many of us have been in situations and seen things you never thought you would see the other side of. And yet the Lord brought you through. He says we should fight for that faith and contend for that faith in all of the dark clouds we see out here going on around us, in other people's lives and loved ones and whatnot. Just keep having faith in the Lord. Keep fighting for the faith to hold on to. I'm going to see it. I'm going to see it change. It's going to happen in their lives. God's not going to leave them out there. He's going to answer. And he goes on to say, and I wasn't going to read all this, but he talks about this is the reason he said what he says, is because there are men that creep in unaware, as it says, ordained. And he talks about the ungodly. And then he says, I put you in remembrance of this in verse 5, though you once knew this. And he talks about how the Lord, after he saved the people out of Egypt, they perished because they didn't believe. And he takes us through some of the things of Sodom and Gomorrah, the angels that didn't keep their first estate. And when we talk about ministering spirits, we'll touch on that a little bit. But Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities like them. And then he talks about filthy dreamers in verse 8, which, listen, there's a lot of that right now. Even over the internet, TV, talk shows, it's like filth. They're filthy dreamers, and now they're speaking their filth out. Anyway, it goes on in verse 9 to talk about Michael the archangel contending with the devil. He disputed about the body of Moses. He didn't bring railing accusation, but said, "The Lord rebuke thee." And Sunday, I'm going to talk about an area with this. I won't say too much about it right now. But the difference between the angels, Jesus, and us. And part of that is in Hebrews chapter 1. But there's a big difference. Why did Michael the archangel say, "The Lord rebuke you," but yet that's not what you and I say? There's a reason. he talks about in verse 10, those who speak evil of dignitaries as brute beasts. And then he says, "Woe unto them who've gone the way of Cain," in verse 11, talks about what they are when they're around you as raging waves of the sea foaming out and spots in your feasts of charities. Then he talks about how even Enoch, the seventh from Adam, proclaimed the judgment of the Lord that was going to come when the Lord comes. He says, and then he talks about how God's going to execute judgment in verse 15. Verse 16, he says, the people, they're murmurers, complainers. They walk after their own lust, which is what we talked about Sunday morning when we talked about love not the world or the things that are in the world, the lusts of the flesh, having other men's persons in admiration because of advantage. In other words, kissing up to somebody because it's going to benefit me down the road. Not telling somebody the truth because if I tell them the truth, I'm not going to get favor from them later on. They're going to not really be as friendly toward me in various things. That's all in there. But then in verse 17, he says, but beloved, listen, and how often can we appeal to one another like this? Listen, saints, brethren, beloved of the Lord, remember the words which were spoken before the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. So here, Jude is backing up what the other disciples taught and preached. He says, remember what the men of God, the apostles of the Lord, had spoken previously, how they told you there'd be mockers in the last time. And we talked about that Sunday morning also in 2 Peter 3, who should walk after their own ungodly lusts. These be they that separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. Listen, everybody, and those of you that are listening out there online. The Holy Spirit working in our lives tempers our sensual desires. He tempers our lusts. Because when Jesus is on the throne of our heart, and the Holy Spirit is working in us, we will begin to desire the things of God more than the things of the world. It's just the proof of the gospel. I put something out earlier today down the same lines of scripture, love not the world, neither the things that are in it. I said the more that we are in Christ, the less of that we desire, because that is not what makes us the person we need to be. It's not what fulfills us. It doesn't strengthen us. I mean, I can have the top-notch Mercedes SUV or the Porsche SUV, and that's not going to save me in a time when everything and everybody is freaked out. But Jesus and the Holy Spirit that is within me, who curbs my sensuality, will save me. The knowledge of the truth and salvation. Remember the words which were spoken before the apostles of our Lord Jesus, how they told you there'd be mockers in the last time. Have we found out that they were right? Do we see that there's mockers out there now? They mock everything we do as believers in Jesus. Just like as Spurgeon said, what was that, 140 years ago? And he basically said the same thing. If they say that these are only platitudes, you say, Lord, bless our food. You say, the Lord gave this day. You say, the Lord is with me as I come and go. Those are platitudes. And that's what Spurgeon was saying. If you say that, well, these are the platitudes that our salvation is built on. If you say it's a crutch, well, here's the crutch that the gospel of the kingdom is built on. It's also the crutch that holds the world in place that you and I are living on. So you ought to be thanking God for the crutch that we have. Amen? Amen. So these are they that separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit, because the Spirit will not continue, as the Bible says, God said, my Spirit will not always strive with men. It's men represents the idea of sensuality, of lust, of flesh, and not serving God. And so he says, my Spirit will not always strive with you. There will come a time when the Lord says, that's it. And as he does, he'll say that also with mankind. It's time for judgment, because he says he's appointed a day. So then he says again, but beloved, in verse 20. I think we need to understand sometimes we're loved more than we understand. We're loved more than we comprehend. We are loved by the Creator of heaven and earth. And although men may not love us or people may not love us, we're loved of God. And what a blessing. But he says, but ye, now, he's talking to you and I, right? As he's talking to the receivers or recipients of the letter, he's saying, but you, beloved, building up yourselves with your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves in the love of God. Keep yourselves. You know, when you go on the airplane and the stewardess does the seat belts and the life raft and the oxygen mask dropping down, what do they tell you when the oxygen mask drops down? Put it on yourself first, right? And then work on others. Look at what the gospel says here. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And of some, that's the passengers riding around you, of some have compassion, making a difference, and then of others. The others are the ones that are riding in a different cabin than you are on the plane. So take care of yourself first, get your oxygen mask on, or we could say your mask today, or we could say get your salvation on first, and then get some by showing them compassion, and then others with fear. Do you see what I'm saying? So you start with yourself, put on your salvation, then you get the person around you, you get them in salvation, and then you go to others and you take them salvation. Some it's having compassion, and others fear. Let's say by the time you got to those in the other cabin, something's already happening. Now, I don't know if something's already happening right now. Everything looks chaotic to me. If you watch some of these things that are going on in other places in the world, again, typhoons, monsoons, earthquakes, flooding, you know, wind storms that are just destroying things, elections and what we're looking at here, just everybody's in an uproar, let alone all of these things are happening during this thing that's going on in the air. So I don't know if you see that as a time to get that life, that oxygen mask on, that salvation put on nice and firm. Make sure you're breathing correct air in the gospel. And then make sure people around you that you have compassion on, you're getting with them and doing the same. And then again, go to the other cabins, maybe some places where you aren't normally around, and take salvation. So it says, be ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith. So he told us to contend for the faith, and now he's telling us to build ourselves up on the faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. You know, earlier today, I think it was just after 9:30 or so, I left the house and was coming out here, and I started praying, and I just started praying in the Spirit, and all that kept coming to my mind is, you know what, Lord, you said if we don't know what to pray, if you don't, we don't know what the people's need is or what they really have holding them back, about praying in the Spirit, praying for the will of God, according to the will of God in people's lives, and just praying in the Spirit. I may know a lot about them. I may see them physically and what they're going through. It's even like this. We might say, well, I hear their story and compassion, but there's another compassion that comes when it's by the Spirit of the Lord. When it's praying for people, not knowing what they really need, but Lord, you know. And so when I allow the Holy Spirit to pray through me in what the Bible says, those unutterable groanings, or, you know, heavenly words, heavenly mysteries, he knows. He knows how to reach them. He knows what they need. He knows what you could never say and I could never say that will open that prison door just enough that they see the light come in and they can come out. Amen? So he says, and of some have compassion, making a difference. Oh, verse 21, let me go back there. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Now, why would he tell us that unless the forces of darkness, we talk about the transference of spirits, we talked about some ungodly spiritual things, least they want to get you out of the love of God. They want to get you out of, you know, you may have done something and you need forgiveness and God won't forgive me. No, he loves us. He will forgive us if we truly repent. When we talk about some of these sin issues that are out here proclaiming themselves to get their rights and everything else today, listen, God still loves these people. And we still have the message of salvation, that message of reconciliation for them. And it may be a hard breakthrough at times, but think about what you and I were like when somebody shared the gospel with us. And if they just said, oh, forget it, they didn't listen to me, and walked away or wouldn't come back or wouldn't try again. That's why he's saying, just like contending for faith. You say, well, I'm really having a battle and, you know, I'm not sure I'm winning the battle. Keep contending. Keep wrestling. Keep fighting. Keep pushing forward in these things. And that's exactly what all this is about. He says, keep yourselves in the love of God. Lord, no matter what I feel like is going on right now, or like you're not doing a thing. And I'm sure some of you have said this as well as I have. And like, Lord, I'm not really seeing anything happen. Is something wrong? Is something going on? Like, how many people are stressed out because, well, you know, I do what I do in my house or my job, and after that, there's really not much to do. I feel like I'm useless. I feel like I'm not achieving anything. Well, think about some of these men, like I said Sunday morning, that were in a pit, that were in a prison. And they'd done nothing wrong. They were servants of God. Yet from that place, God brought them out of the pit. He didn't just bring them out of the pit. He brought them to places of authority. He brought them to a highlighted place, because that's what he does. He lifts us up. So keep yourselves in the love of God. And what's it say in all of this? We're looking for the mercy of God. We're looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, because we desperately need his mercy. And we're to be looking for it, it says. Why would we need to look for it if things aren't going to happen that we totally need to realize, I'm not making it, I'm not causing it to happen. Lord, have mercy. And how many things have gone on in our lives already where you can't think of anything else to say but, Lord, have mercy. And you say it in a mad way, Lord, have mercy. Or you say, Lord, have mercy. I don't know what to do. I don't know where this is going. I don't know how it's going to end up. I need your mercy in all of this. Amen? Because we are at the mercy of the Lord in all of this. So looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. It's his mercy that we're going to make it to that gate one day, and he's going to say, enter in, thou good and faithful servant. It's his mercy in all of this. It's his mercy that was shed on us when we realized what a sinner we were. And since then, his mercy has picked us up again over and over. His mercy hasn't left us out there in the fields where we were, or in the wallow where we were. It's brought us in. So we're to be looking for that mercy, and the end of that is eternal life. So he says, and some have compassion, making a difference. Because the love we show them, the mercy we show them, the forgiveness we show them, it's okay we show them, it's going to have a difference. It's going to make a difference. And think about some of the things in your own life when you thought somebody, because in your mind you build up this thing of this is how they are and this is how they'll respond and this is what they'll do. And when you said what you said, the response was totally different. Proving that you had a vain imagination. It wasn't true. And that wasn't how they were. Wasn't how they dealt with the situation. Wasn't how they came about. And I would pray in all of us that we would see, again, that's God's mercy. Amen? So if some have compassion, making a difference, and others save with fear. Now, sometimes you could say this is the thing, what do we call it, tough love. You've tried to be nice. And you could say even with your children when you were raising them, some may be raising children now, you try to do it calmly, collectively, with all your hair in, not yelling, Lord, have mercy. And that has not worked so far. And suddenly you say, this is some that I've had compassion on, but it doesn't seem to be making a difference, so I guess these are the others that I need to save with fear. We have one of our, I'll just say children, who has children, who says when I give them this arr face, suddenly they listen. I think that's the save with fear, because now they're not going to have to get paddled because they got the message from that fearful face. So some save with fear, pulling them out of the fire. What does the fire represent? It means that they're very close to being judged in the sins that they're in what they're living in, and maybe being overcome with this thing. Pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. When you and I know somebody and we respect them as people of God, as saints, as our brethren, and suddenly you hear them telling foul, dirty jokes and making lewd gestures and actions, you see their garment is now being spotted by the flesh. It's repulsive. You should hate to see that. And so that's what he's saying here. Others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. I hate to see they would act this way, that they would stoop to that, that they would be maybe deceived or manipulated and have gone that far in their minds from the position where they once were. Then it says in verse 24, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling. Right? We're preserved in Jesus. We're kept by the power of God. And now to him that's able to keep us from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory, not with agony or suffering, but with exceeding joy. Again, because we're kept by the power of God. Unto him who's able to keep you from falling, to present you faultless before the presence of his glory, the presence of all of his goodness. Remember when the Lord told Moses, I'll cause all of my goodness to pass before you, when he said, show me your glory, with exceeding joy. And you know, I don't think any of us really knows what that exceeding joy is yet. What did we get in the beginning? We got mercy, we got peace and love, and now we're talking about getting exceeding joy. A joy that there's no refrain from. You know, here in the earth, you may say, well, this is really a joyous time, but I wonder if somebody's going to cripple it. I wonder if there's something wrong here because we're having a good time and somebody's got to spoil this. Or, you know what, this won't go on forever. It's like a euphoria. And I feel totally calm, at peace, and happy, and just the love of the Lord. But we know the thief is here, right? And he's always out to steal, kill, and destroy. We know that he uses his ministers, as the Bible refers to them, to hinder and harm us if we allow them. So we know our joy is usually short-lived, isn't it? But the joy that the Lord gives is long-lasting. So he says, to him that's able to keep you from falling, that's you and me, and to present you faultless. I use that spray starch on my shirt. It's called faultless. I don't see any of it after I run the iron over it, so I guess it is faultless. It doesn't mess anything up, and it holds in place. But he says he's going to present you and I faultless. In other words, wherever we were, at that point in time, it's all over and done. It's gone. We are clean. Our garments are not spotted with the flesh, like we read in verse 23 there. We're faultless before the Lord. The presence of his glory. We're going to see all of his goodness. Something we really can't imagine here in the earth. And with exceeding joy. Verse 25 says, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. Amen. So I'm just going to stop right there. I'm not going to go any further. We're going to talk about, as I said, ministering angels on Sunday morning. We're going to talk about in the book of Acts when Peter was in prison in chapter 12 of Acts. He had a visitation and many things that we can talk about. There are people in prisons in their mind right now. There are people that are imprisoned in other countries because of their love of the Lord, just like Peter was in prison for, and for doing some of the very things like Peter did when it talks about the woman that had the spirit that brought much gain to the people, the very reason Peter was imprisoned. So we'll talk about some of those things Sunday morning, and I pray that that's going to be ministry to you also. But I do thank the Lord tonight in this. I pray that people are being ministered to and blessed, and we need to be reminded. Now, you heard Spurgeon say some of the basics we all need to be reminded of over and over again. Although we need to keep growing, we need to be pruned, like we talked about Sunday morning. We want to bear fruit, and when these branches bear fruit, we're going to be pruned so that we bring forth more fruit and an abundance of fruit. Amen. So in all of this, there was another quote part of this quote that I didn't read, where Spurgeon talked about us always going to progress more and more In other words, we don't say, I'm 65 years old now, so I don't go any further in these things, or I don't need to learn anymore. And so there we are, 100 and, what did I say, 40 years ago, saying the same thing we're talking about now, because the gospel's the same. So in that, we're all blessed. And again, thanks for listening. Those of you that are with us online tonight, thanks for listening in. Hope that's been a blessing to you. Don't forget, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, John 3:3 says you must be born again to see the kingdom of God. Otherwise, you will never see it. Get in a good church where you're at. Make sure you're listening to a pastor who's preaching the gospel. And as we talked about here a little while ago, there's a lot of them who are denying the Lord Jesus, as it says in part of Jude, that he's the only way into the kingdom. Get out of those churches and get to a church that preaches Jesus Christ crucified. He's the way of salvation. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. God bless. Have a good night.